I'm Amor Towles. My relatively new novel, A Gentleman in Moscow, has a rather unusual premise in that it opens at a Bolshevik tribunal in the Kremlin in 1922, where a 30-year-old aristocrat is being interviewed. In the course of this brief interview, it becomes clear that the Count wrote a poem as a young man that was very popular with the revolutionary generation. So he has some friends in the upper ranks of the party, as it were. But on the other hand, it's also clear that he's an unrepentant aristocrat. So as something of a compromise, the tribunal decides that the Count can go back to the hotel where he's been staying, and if he ever comes out of the hotel again, he will be shot. With the snap of a gavel, he's marched out of the Kremlin, across Red Square, through the doors of the historic Metropole Hotel, which is where he spends the next 32 years. And that's where I ask you as the reader to spend 32 years with him. I'll start by saying that my interest in Russia generally really stems from falling in love with the great Russian literature of the 19th century, reading Dostoevsky and Tolstoy, and Chekhov, and Gogol, and the others. And so that's kind of why, as an American living in New York, I was intrigued about the notion about writing a story set in Russia. But while it is a story set in Russia, an advantage it has for readers, for instance, in America, is that because the whole story takes place inside the hotel is actually a very familiar space to anybody in the West. Between 1890 and 1910, roughly, is when grand hotels were being opened across Europe and across the United States, along the Mediterranean, and along the Florida coast. And the grand hotels tended to have a great deal in common as you went from city to city to city. They were all the size of a city block with hundreds of rooms. They had it at great palm court where they would serve tea in the afternoon, multiple restaurants, an American bar, a library, a telegraph office, a place to put a card room for playing cards. All the grand hotels looked very similar because they were serving the same wealthy, sophisticated travelers that had begun to go around Europe on their grand European tours or going into America. So any of us who've come of age in the 20th century or the early 21st century, who's even stopped in at one of the famous hotels in Paris or London or along the Mediterranean, will immediately recognize the space in which this story takes place. Because the Metropole, which is a real hotel in Moscow that was opened in 1905, is a hotel very much of that kind. Not that different than the grand hotels that you would find in any other European capital. The story centers around the Count, as I've mentioned, and when he enters the hotel, he's 30 years old. He was born in 1890 and is of aristocratic upbringing. And the reality of the aristocracy in Russia in the 19th century is that they were very similar to the aristocracy in England or France or Vienna or Spain in the 19th century. The people of that class tended to share many cultural attributes, share a sense of etiquette. They had read the same books, studied the same art, listened to the same music. And in fact, as you went from country to country, that generation of nobility tended to have more in common with each other than they had with their own countrymen in England or France or Spain. And so the Count is very much a representative of that 19th century aristocratic cultural sensibility. He's never had a job in his life, in other words. But so after the revolution, when he is sentenced to life in the hotel, his cultural world has been stripped away from him. His possessions are gone, his wealth is gone, his social standing's gone. And so what he has to do within the confines of the hotel is discover a new life. He has to establish new relationships. He has to find new causes for happiness, however small, and ultimately he must find a new sense of purpose. And while I won't give away all the elements of the story, one of the ways that he initially does this is he gets a job. He becomes a waiter in the fine restaurant in the hotel. And what he quickly discovers, and what everyone discovers, is that he's the perfect waiter. If you take Russia in 1920, after the revolution, in a fine restaurant, a former aristocrat is the perfect waiter because he's been trained in cuisine, he's been trained in wine, he speaks multiple languages, he's been trained in etiquette. So there was, in essence, nobody better to be a waiter than a member of the former nobility. But that's how he begins to climb his way back into the experience of life and find a new sense of purpose within the hotel. Now, of course, it begins, in essence, with a job, but it's ultimately about the relationships that he forms, whether that's with his fellow colleagues, the chef, the maitre d' of the restaurant, but then the other guests in the hotel. He befriends a famous actress who stays at the hotel regularly. He befriends a young girl who is living in the hotel with her father, who's a member of the party. He is approached by a member of the government who wants to get insight into the culture and language of the West, and so befriends him. And so over the course of this time, even though he's trapped in the hotel, he is making connections, forming relationships, and as a result, we get a glimpse of what's going on outside of the walls of the hotel throughout the tumultuous three decades of the Soviet era. I think that for those readers who enjoyed my first book, which was also translated into French, in English, it was called Rules of Civility. In French, it's Règles du jeu. That's a very different story in many ways because it's about a 25-year-old woman in New York City in 1938. And the whole book takes place over a single year. In many ways, A Gentleman in Moscow is the opposite of that story in that it's about an aging gentleman as opposed to a young woman. It's about a man who had come from a very wealthy background, whereas Règles du jeu is about a woman from a working class background who's working her way up in the world. And very importantly, Rules of Civility or Règles du jeu is just about a year in the life of a girl, of a young woman, whereas A Gentleman in Moscow spans 30 years. So the two books, I think, will, for those who enjoyed the first book, they will find many of the same satisfactions in A Gentleman in Moscow, but stretched over a much larger period of time, and that allows the book to take on a much greater scope.